Hey everyone, hope you all had a great long weekend. I'm going to be going over the events for the week. So to start off, we have intramural pickleball signups, which will be going on all week. So be sure to get on IMLinks and sign up for your team. And then kicking off Welcome Back Week on Tuesday, we have the We Survived 2020 party. It'll be from 8 to 10 in Cook Center. Then on Wednesday, we will have the basketball fan zone in Cook Center. It will have a food truck and prizes that'll be from 6 to 9, so we hope to see you out there. On Friday, we will be having Family Feud in Bell Center at 7:30. Teams will be picked throughout the night, so be sure to show up with the team, and we will also have some prizes. And then on Saturday, we have the escape room from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. You can sign up your team in the CAF all week this week. And then times will be every 30 minutes throughout Saturday. And then Tuesday, we have the staff versus student showdown. And that'll be in Cook Center at 9 o'clock. So we hope to see you guys out there and hope you guys all have a great week.
Well, good morning, everyone. And thank you for joining us today for chapel in honor of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. On behalf of MidAmerica Nazarene and the Student Diversity Council, we welcome you this morning. So this year's chapel is different, obviously, as you all are online, but rest assured, as Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s dream has not changed and is still worthy of being recognized and celebrated. So our theme for today, and actually the entire week, is from dreamers to bridge builders. And we have been long anticipating this chapel, that it may bring light to people so desperately in need of escaping darkness. May we choose to cling to Christ and unity as a congregation and pass on light in the months to come. I don't know about you guys, but I'm so thankful that this week would begin with such a message of hope, of light, and peace. So let us prepare ourselves for a time of worship led by MNU's own Heritage Choir and directed by Dr. Chris Smith. They are sure to deliver a beautiful song, but above all, this is a time to worship Jesus together as this great and diverse community gathered today in the presence of God. Know that these moments are not wasted, for our worship is a declaration of peace and praise, glory to his name. So would you join us as we sing in just a moment? And if these songs are unfamiliar to you, we invite you to take whatever posture necessary that would allow God to speak to your heart directly. And may the light and the life of Jesus meet us today through the legacy of Dr. King.
Well, it is my pleasure to welcome you all today for this very special day on our campus. Whether you're joining us here in the sanctuary or you're joining us live stream, thank you for making this day a special day on our campus. We know many of you will be watching live stream on our campus community, but many of you will join us from our greater community, and maybe even many of you around the world will join us today. I want to extend a special welcome to our special guests and also to our speaker today, who will be introduced shortly. Our theme this year is From Dreamers to Bridge Builders. The theme is basically dreaming is wonderful, but it's got to have action behind it. And so From Dreamers to Bridge Builders really follows our whole theme for this year as we've looked at our community and how to strengthen it, to listen, to really listen, to learn, to serve, learn how to serve together, but most importantly grow, but grow together. So we are attempting today to begin to commit to ourselves again to be bridge builders. We're deeply grateful to the support that our sponsors give us. Our sponsors allow us not only to have this day, but also to provide resources to fund our MLK leadership scholarships that we'll be awarding today. And we thank you for them, and their names will be scrolling on the screens today. Martin Luther King's Living Legacy event is now 15 years old. This is the 15th annual celebration. Not only do we intend to inspire the hopes and dreams of a new generation, but we want to challenge each other to pursue the challenge that he gave for us now so many years ago. We cannot let that die. Dr. King challenged us to love each other as Christ loved the church. That's a pretty high calling. And to love each other as neighbors and community and to have important conversations. It is our goal to do that in the name of Christ and as a model of those who are striving to live and work together in peace and hope and justice. So today we're delighted to have our Heritage Choir with us today. They do amazing work, and we're so thrilled to have them here under the direction of Dr. Christopher Smith. Please join me as we welcome the Heritage Choir.
Thank you. I have a dream.
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 I have a dream that everyone can understand that what we are going through right now with the social climate, that we can all be able to understand people's reality and be able to relate and be able to get to the bottom of how we can come together to be one united country and community.
My dream is for every person to recognize the dignity and humanity of everyone and to truly treat each person the way we treat ourselves.
For peace and unity to be restored.
That people will become regular and stop being racist.
For racism to end.
I had a dream that people would share cadres all the time. Amen.
Big and strong, and I want to be a firefighter.
That we could get through COVID and that we could go back to the regular life.
My dream is to help people learn how to truly love one another without prejudice.
To one day be a doctor when I grow up.
What's your dream?
My dream in life is for everybody to be equal.
My dream for this country and this world is that one day we'll be truly able to set our differences aside and come together in peace.
To one day be a that one
to be a history teacher and make a positive influence on people's lives.
My dream is that neighbors near and far will be more understanding and be able to put themselves in each other's shoes.
To be a wonderful father, a wonderful husband, and to raise a beautiful black family that exceeds expectations that society has put on them. I want them to be intelligent young men and women. I want them to love God. I want them to go on and just do great things to influence this world and this country.
I have a dream.
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 That's a really good dream.
Okay.
Hey, you're a man.
Are we done?
Mic drop. Peace out.
Good morning. We are pleased to honor our MLK student leaders today. The Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Scholarship is awarded each year to promising students of diverse ethnicities who exemplify a pioneering spirit, a passion to serve, and a purposeful life. Applicants are selected based on their demonstration of criteria that models the life, vision, and principles of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Recipients must maintain academic excellence, participate in community service, and represent MidAmerica Nazarene University with a heart of love and servant leadership on campus and in the community. Please come forward as I call your name to receive your certificate of recognition. Layella Phillips. Denasia Whitehead. And Karen Campbell. Let's congratulate these students.
If you guys would take a moment and just join me in this scripture reading, I think that sometimes when we show up to chapel, whether it be virtual or in person, we're just here to get a point. But I think that the Lord's word rang true when they were writing it down and speaking it to one another, and it rings true today, and who God says we are has not changed over the centuries, that we are his people and that we were created equal. And so if you would just take a moment and just receive this word with me. And it comes from Colossians chapter 3, and we'll be reading verses 11 through 15. Here there is not Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Cynthian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. Put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgive each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you must also forgive. And above all, these put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Thank you. Good morning. We are honored today to recognize and celebrate the life and legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Our theme for our celebration this year is From Dreamers to Bridge Builders, where we reflect on Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s dream and put it into action. In these difficult times we face in our world, it is important to be the change we want to see to improve our campus and our community. In the words of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., the time is always right to do what is right. Each year, we have recognized those whose lives represent the impact of Dr. King's dream, and today we want to honor such a person as one who is honoring the dream in our community and is truly building bridges to make our world a better place. Dr. Tiffany Anderson is the first African-American female superintendent of Topeka Public Schools, and she has been a public school educator for over 27 years. In addition to her role as superintendent, Dr. Anderson advises Kansas on post-secondary and equity policies. In 2019, Kansas Governor, Governor Laura Kelly, appointed Dr. Anderson to the Post-Secondary Technical Education Authority as part of the Kansas Board of Regents, and in 2020, Governor Kelly appointed Dr. Anderson to co-chair the Governor's Kansas Commission on Racial Equity and Justice. Dr. Anderson has served as a public and post-secondary health advocate and has improved achievement and closed achievement gaps for students in multiple states. She serves on several boards in Topeka that support youth and is a member of the Greater Topeka Chamber Board. She is also a lifetime member of the NAACP. Dr. Anderson is a professor for practice for Kansas State and adjunct faculty for the Association for Schools and Curriculum Development, where she serves on their 9-member National Poverty Cadre, which trains districts across the nation. Dr. Anderson serves on numerous Topeka business and not-for-profit boards and on the International Sex Trafficking Board. Dr. Anderson has national documentaries that were created about her work with addressing poverty and transforming communities. She also has received numerous recognitions like the Lifetime Achievement Award for volunteerism from President Obama, the Salute to Excellence for Women awarded by the Urban League, the Stellar Performance Award by the St. Louis American, and the Award for Diversity in Business from the St. Louis Business Journal, just to name a few. Please help me welcome our guest speaker, Dr. Tiffany Anderson.
Good morning. It is a privilege to be here. This is a sanctuary that holds 3,000, and today there are but a handful scattered about so that those of us that have the privilege to stand here can speak to the masses by live stream. Again, it is an honor and privilege. Let me first say that I give all honor and glory to God, who is the head of my household, and I thank my parents for instilling in me a love for the Lord that leads me and guides me. And I pray that today everyone in the sound of my voice leaves uplifted, encouraged, moving from dreamers to bridge builders. And if you're already building bridges, which I know that you are from this university, that you leave today knowing that the work that has started has only just begun, and God's promises will be fulfilled. So as I start this morning, I have a few clips in the few moments that I have with you. I'm going to share with you a little bit of a walk this morning. It is so interesting. And I will first say I thank Ms. Gibson, the administrative assistant behind the scenes, because when I speak, I never write what I'm going to say in advance. I pray that evening, pray that morning, and that is the message that is meant for you. So Ms. Gibson got a clip this morning, and then walking through the door, another clip was given and a slideshow, and they scurried about and ensured that we have today some things that I think are especially meant for you. As we pull up the slide today and we look at the legacy, I want to say not only a thank you, but also ask that God protect, guide, and lead the president of this university. I spoke with him about his decade of work and what's before him as it is before me. And my goodness, so much weighs on our shoulders for students, for faculty, for presidents of universities. And with that, these words, I believe, are meant for you and for me. As we pull up the slide this morning, they know me well here. I've only spoken once, and they know that I will walk all through this and forget that I'm on film and walk all through the service and walk all through the sanctuary. So they're keeping me still right here to talk to you. They know me well. They know that I'll have a slideshow and go clipping through that and go back and forward. So I thank you for those in the background that are controlling that slide as we go through this handful of slides and a clip to share with you this morning. That photo, for those of you who I have not had the privilege to meet, I am the first Black female superintendent in Topeka, Kansas. The photo that you see now is of the stairway of the great Capitol that I pass by every day on the way to my office. And the photo that you saw preceding that was Dr. Martin Luther King marching to end legal segregation. As I stand on the shoulders of the great people that come before me, I thought this morning it would be best to start with some words from Dr. King. And with that, I wasn't sure, I couldn't remember quite the theme. The young lady spoke about bridge builders and dreamers, and no wonder that I came across one of the sermons, and I have a collection of his sermons on tape, where he talked about Rip Van Winkle sleeping through a revolution. And I thought for a moment last night, maybe that's what I should start with. And then I thought about life's blueprint. We're standing here in a university of people that are being empowered with wisdom and with the foundation of theology that's going to guide you. So maybe life's blueprint would have been perfect for you to hear, to talk about the keys of life. And then as I went to sleep and woke up this morning around 2 or 3 a.m. and I turned back on my collection of sermons and I came across the sermon, The Other America. Dr. King's sermon about the other people's America. And it is amazing that in preparing to come, I came across the old familiar sermon. And no wonder, given the theme. You know, I know the award you give talks about legacy and living the legacy, and so I thought maybe that was a large part of the theme, but the sermon that I landed on was I Have a Dream. Amazing how God orchestrates all things. So I'm going to play a 1-minute clip from that sermon and then share a few words with you.
We've got some difficult days ahead, but it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. And I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place, but I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. mountain, and I've looked over, and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
How perfect. So let me tell you what we'll be talking about today. We're going to talk about purpose. We're going to talk about possibility, and we're going to talk about God's promise that we stand on. So as we go to this next slide, let me share with you a little bit about purpose and possibility and promise. And those are my two children. My goodness. Now, while we are all God's children, the two that I fed in my house for the 20 plus years, Whitney and Christopher, I pray that they will see a world that looks very different than it does now as they have children. And as their children have children, I pray they can stand on the shoulders and the legacy of everyone that has come before us and work collectively with others to ensure that we can fulfill together our purpose and walk into our destiny. As we go to this next piece of thinking about purpose, I said this the last time that I was here. You see, there are no mistakes in life. You are positioned on purpose. To our president of this university, you are positioned perfectly for right now. As he shared with me his obedience to making sure that the university was available and open to young people. To the young lady that sang, Janelle Johnson, it's amazing because when I started in Topeka, Kansas, one of the unanimous votes was an African-American board member, female board member, Janelle Johnson. So I noticed your name when I walked in. You, young lady, are positioned on purpose. And so Dr. King knew that he was positioned on purpose. So as that sermon shared and he talked about seeing the promised land and standing on a mountaintop, knowing that he is positioned on purpose to lead and guide, to love and inspire. You see, I'm the daughter of two pastors, and so when we talk about New Testament and Old Testament, I'm going to give you two scriptures, and I'm going to preference Dr. King's words as kind of a Old Testament piece, a foretelling of where we are today. You know, it was on Sunday that I started my morning, and this past Sunday, and I always listen to sermons and have worship all day. I attend my church, Church of Resurrection. I attend Temple of Deliverance online, which is in Memphis, Tennessee, where Bishop Patterson, my late husband, is from Memphis. I attend Friendship Baptist, Missionary Baptist Church, and attend their Sunday school as a visitor now for years, every Sunday. But this past Sunday, I added a church. I went to Ebenezer Baptist Church, where the great Reverend Warmack, on this next slide, was preaching a powerful sermon. We're going to move from Old Testament to New Testament. The New Testament scripture that he spoke was from Luke. You see, Reverend Warnock is at Ebenezer Baptist Church. It is no accident that at this moment, he's the new senator leading Georgia, and he is a pastor for over 15 years at the very church Dr. King preached at. His scripture, and I know it's up on the screen for all of you, but I'm going to read it directly from the NIV version. And he started off, and let me give you some context. The context behind this is that this is a time in which the people are being comforted. And in the book of Luke, chapter 3, verses 4 through 6, for those that can't quite see the screen that are listening, I want to talk about this wilderness place that you may be standing in. Whether you have COVID, have lost someone to COVID, are unemployed, or are just fearful of the uncertainty ahead. At this time, Luke was talking about the time that he was in and looking at how we encourage moving forward the people that are looking for words of comfort and wisdom. It says, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight paths for him. Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain and hill made low, the crooked roads made straight. The crooked roads made straight. The rough ways smooth. And all the people will see God's salvation. Not some of the people, but all of the people. And so I listened to that scripture. And he started with saying, as it is written from the book of Isaiah. You see, Luke was standing at a time where John the Baptist was sharing that this is not the end. There is promise and possibility ahead of us. And so in his words, he was filling the people with some words of comfort and encouragement. So as I listened to Reverend Warnock preach on Sunday, I went back to the Old Testament. Let me share with you the words of Isaiah. And I looked at, this is Isaiah chapter 40, and I read all of chapter 40, but I'm just going to highlight one section. Now, just to give you context, which I know all of you already know this, but Isaiah was speaking at a time in which he was comforting the people that were in exile, saying after exile, y'all, we're standing in exile. We are standing in a wilderness, but after the wilderness journey, things will be better. How do we know this? Because my God said it was so. So in that scripture, in Isaiah, I'm reading the New International Version. He says, comfort, comfort, my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her heart's service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, and that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level. We're talking about leveling the playing field here. The rugged places a plain, and the glory of the Lord will be revealed. And all the people will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. You see, hearing and living the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is hearing and living the legacy of Jesus Christ. So as we think about possibility and as we think about promise, I'm going to take you through a brief step in the wilderness journey. Because this is reality. You see, God never promised that we wouldn't have wilderness times, but he promised he would be with us through it. As we move into these next few slides and as my time with you begins to wind up, as Dr. King was preaching that I Have a Dream speech just months earlier, take a look at the photo of him literally being pushed down on his knees. Think about those that are pushed down by oppression, pushed down by hate, pushed down by divisiveness. That picture doesn't look too different than the one in 2020, where you can't tell George Floyd's face from the pavement because it is so close to the pavement, where literally a man died with a knee physically on his neck. You know, when we think about this wilderness journey, we have to say we shall overcome in a whole new way. Why? Because my God said so. The crooked will be straight. Rough places made smooth. When we think about the Ahmaud Arbery, I can remember the time in which my son Christopher, I had to talk to him about driving and when you drive and if you get stopped and don't talk back and put your hands on the wheel. And this is today. This is not in 1968. But now my son who's moved away, I have to talk to him about running while black. I have to talk to my daughter Whitney about sleeping while black. When we think of the Breonna Taylors, we have to remember we shall overcome. Why? Because my God said so, that we are not dreamers. We are bridge builders. It's why we're here. You are positioned on purpose. So as we think about this moment we're in, and I came in and young people talked about, wow, they're going to be streaming online and instead of being in this 3,000 space sanctuary. You think about COVID and all of the impacts of the pandemic. I want you to know we shall overcome. Every picture that you see after today, every news piece clip that you look at, I want you to say in your mind, we shall overcome because my God said so. And if you have to go to a scripture, go right here to the wilderness scripture. If you look for another scripture in Romans, it says we're conquerors. It says in Romans 8:37, knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors. That means we're super conquerors. Through him who loved us. How do I know? Because my God said so. So when you are discouraged, know that you, sir, are more than a conqueror. You are more than a conqueror. But you have to remember, much like Dr. King, who one day was pushed down on his knee and the next day was saying, I have a dream, that you are a dreamer that will move to being a bridge builder because you're going to stand on God's promises. As Dr. King said in one of his speeches about Rip Van Winkle, who was sleeping a revolution, we must wake up. It's good to dream, but once you dream it, you have to put love, that's Christ, in action. It's why I wear the tennis shoes, sneakers to the ground. So stand on God's promises and remember that scripture, every valley shall be raised up. So those in poverty, those discouraged, every mountain and hill made low, the rough shall become level as we build bridges and level the playing field. The rugged places a plain. You know, Reverend Warnock said on Sunday in his sermon, he talked about the purchasing power of the minimum wage when we think about the poor. And in 1968, the minimum wage had more purchasing power than it does today. The rough ground shall become level. We must be bridge builders to level the playing field. The rugged places a plain. And so here's the good news for today. There is good news. And this good news that is stated in scripture that we've just read twice over, both in Isaiah foretelling the Christ's return and again in Luke, here's the good news.
Those pictures down below are my babies from Jennings School District, which is almost 100% free lunch. I now work in Topeka, Kansas, but I have to share that if a school district with 100% poverty can have almost 100% graduation and college going rate, we all can make sure that the rough ground can be level. We all can make sure that the rugged can be plain. So I pray that we all have the courage to unapologetically, fearlessly build bridges where no one else may choose to go. So very quickly, and I know that my time has come to a close, I'm going to share with you just a few promises just to encourage you and conclude with just a small clip. It's 4 minutes, but I'm only going to show probably 30 seconds of it of a student. This very next slide just shows some of the promises of today. Now, Dr. King, and this says Vice President-elect Harris, so something got mixed up because we know that's not Vice President-elect Harris. But it says we've got to give ourselves to the struggle until the end. Either we go up together or we go down together. Now, there should be a few slides of just some promises. And there we go, Vice President-elect Harris. Y'all know I'm excited about this. Not only because I'm the first female African-American superintendent in Topeka, Kansas. Just think about that. Think about Brown v. Board was a little bit over 60 years ago, and it took that long to have a black female superintendent. Think about the fact that there's only two of us in the entire state and there are over 300 superintendents. Think about there are only four black superintendents in the entire state and one Hispanic in Kansas. So the promise is that when I started, I was it in Kansas, and we do now have four. The promise is that without one, you can't have a second without a first. So Vice President-elect Harris, I'm so excited about a sister from an HBCU is the first Vice President-elect female African-American Vice President. I am so excited. And so, of course, Reverend Warnock moved from Reverend Warnock to Senator Warnock. Also an HBCU graduate. I bring that up because HBCUs underfunded, undersupported, struggling universities, producing first-rate leaders, producing the first African-American female vice president, producing the first black senator of Georgia. You see, we shall overcome if you stand on God's promises. It is no accident that he is the pastor of Ebenezer Baptist Church. It's no accident that the inauguration is the week of Dr. Martin Luther King's birthday. We are divinely positioned on purpose. Are you listening? Are you seeking to serve? Are you seeking to understand that so you can serve others and build bridges in ways that those bridges can't be torn down? I think about the powerful black female mayor, Mayor Bowser in D.C. My goodness, she's had a challenging last handful of years, and she's in her second term. Black female mayor in D.C. You see, we shall overcome. That's good news. So as we live this legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., I'm going to remind us, now I'm going to go Old Testament, Isaiah 40, and the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together. All people will see it together. You see Dr. King's quote that either we're going to get there together or we're not going to get there at all. Division is the devil of distraction, and I want you to remember that. And so building bridges breaks the division and breaks the divide. I thank you for that theme, and I thank you for the work that all of you do. Very briefly, I'm going to show a small clip because everything we do, everything you do today, builds bridges for the children of tomorrow. So So we're going to end with a small clip from a high school student. She wrote a poem. And again, it's 4 minutes. I'll send it to you to have. But I'm going to show just a small clip of that as we conclude. Kiora Brooks is the student. She is a Topeka West graduate. She is right now attending a university in St. Louis, University of Missouri, St. Louis, and a brilliant young lady.
Melanin, rich melanin, my rich dark skin. To love it or to hate it is the question. One I never ask, yet I get answers. My skin seems like a trap as they hunt me down because of it. Armed with playful words, comparisons, and blatant disrespect. My life, it seems, to start to shift when the reality of my dark skin hits. My perspective dropped me down a bit. My hopes and dreams no longer seem to fit into the realities others forced upon me. Media feeds into this corruption, connecting dark skin with all kinds of ugliness. To them, we define the word while incorporating violence and a lack of intelligence. The masses take this as a solid truth. They're taught that dark-skinned people are lazy, always acting crazy, sitting in a hole they can easily get out of if they try. Stereotypes like this continue to persist, but we're different than these lies being sold as truth. I represent people with skin like me. I strive to create a name that'll trigger a chain of positive images of me and others with skin the same. I'll have no need to hide in shame or try to change. I come from my mother. What a beauty. His brain is like no other. She has rich skin like mine that people try to smother. They pack the negatives atop our skin as if being dark is a sin, as if our melanin causes them offense, makes them go on defense, and their offensive goal is to tear the color off our skin. Now, of course, that's not literal, but imaginations have gone far. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. Light is right, gets whispered in our ears. Our melanin children repeat the phrase. When they're out playing, they stick to an area of shade, saying they're dark enough already. Why make it worse? The sun, which gives us energy, makes our skin glow, is now the enemy for bringing our skin to its true hue. In the summer, black girls would rather swim in bleach than in a pool. If only you were lighter. No one's gonna like a girl with dark skin. These are the things being said to our little dark girls. Images of pretty light-skinned women on the TV, yet no one's positively represent the little dark girl's shade. How is she left to think of herself? Who's going to show her that her melanin isn't a mistake? She isn't old enough to understand that her mother is the only positive image she needs. But even if she is, her mother might be fighting demons in her skin as well. Now where does that lead the little dark girl? Back to the TV, to images that don't positively represent her shade, making her play hide and seek with the sun when it's recess because she's dark enough already. Why make it worse? These words always trap us in a cycle of negativity smothering our skin. Them dark girls, they ain't feminine. When the lights dim, where do the dark skins go? I can't see you. We don't have that in your shade. You're too pretty to be so dark. You've been in the sun too long. I hope I don't get as dark as you. Getting stuck in this can take us to the brink of madness. We need it to break. Dark skin is ugly. Dark skin is weird. Dark skin is gross. Dark skin is, to you, always something negative. Dark skin is not what you say it is. My skin is not what you make of it. Dark skin is magnificent. Dark skin holds beauty. The statement, beauty is in the eye of the beholder, is true.
Beauty is in the eye of the beholder. As we turn that down, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. And I hold that statement to be true. You are beautiful. As I behold you right now, I can't even see those who are streaming. You are beautiful. I am Dr. Tiffany Anderson, that black girl that she talked about that's dark. That is beautiful, that is beholding you, no matter what your color is, no matter what shade of brown, or what shade of pink, or what shade of coffee, you are beautiful. Why? Because my God said so. So be the bridge builders. Start with your dream, but don't stop there. Start with standing on God's promises, but don't stop there. You see, work is crucial. Faith without deeds will be dead. So I will tell you, be the dream builders. I thank you for having me here today, and I leave you with the comment that I started with, that we stand on God's promises. You are the promises of the future. Fearlessly, courageously, explore the possibilities. Build bridges where no one else may have before. And know that you belong, because my God said so. Thank you.
Dr. Anderson, I want to thank you for being God's voice for this purpose and this day. Thank you so much for sharing with us. And for those of us that are here and for those that are watching online, regardless of where you are, whether faculty, staff, students, or friend of the university, we take great pride in the fact that we call ourselves pioneers. That means we get out in front. We go where no one else dares to go. And a lot of times we say then that we are not settlers, and sometimes we say that pretty flippantly and somewhat proudly. But in all reality, what that simply means is we're not going to be willing to settle for anything less than God's best for us as individuals, as a university, or for our world. And so today, as we build bridges, we have been challenged not to be settlers for anything less than what God has designed for all of us to be. So thank you, Dr. Anderson, for sharing that important word. It is our pleasure each year for the past 15 years to recognize someone who models the legacy of faith and action of Dr. Martin Luther King. We call this the Living Legacy Award. Dr. Anderson, you're living today, so that's great. And you've brought us a living word. Those challenges that are given to us by modeling and by words are an inspiration to us all, and especially to this campus. From generation to generation, that challenge cannot be neglected. And we heard it again today. Dr. King pursued equality for all in the nation, in our communities, and also on behalf of our campus. And so to addition, the call of Jesus Christ on all of us is to lead in this commitment to freedom and liberty and justice for all. This year, Dr. Anderson, we are honored to recognize you for your leadership, your service, and the fulfillment of this legacy of faith and service that you've demonstrated in action as a community leader. You faithfully served your students, you faithfully served your school district and your community, but you've also faithfully served your Lord. You have and will continue to be an inspiring bridge builder. Perhaps we all need to get tennis shoes and follow her example. You have been an inspiration to us. It is fitting and appropriate today that this community recognizes and honors your commitment to serve others, to carry on the legacy of faith in action that Dr. King provided and that you have challenged us to pursue today. So today it is our honor to present the Martin Luther King Living Legacy Award to Dr. Tiffany Anderson. Would you join me in congratulating her, please? Dr. Anderson, this particular award is special meaning to us because it was crafted by one of our former students, who's a great artist. And what it says is the 2021 Martin Luther King Jr. Living Legacy Award presented to Dr. Tiffany Anderson, and this quote from Dr. King, "Until justice rolls down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., 1963, may those words still resonate in 2021. Would you congratulate her again?
Thank you. And I'm not sure that there's more words to say beyond what was said other than to read that one more time. This is absolutely amazing. The student that crafted this, I have to do a personal reach out. Until justice rolls down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. My God be with you. Thank you. I will just say one small, I know we're going to conclude with prayer. But for everyone that is in this room, for our president, and for those that are listening online, may God be with you, may God keep you, may God direct you, and may God give you courage to build bridges where no man has gone before. In your holy and precious name, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Dr. Tiffany Anderson, for that wonderful word. I'm going to close this out in prayer, so if you all bow your heads. Thank you, God, for this wonderful day and for bringing Dr. Tiffany Anderson to our campus to share this word for us and reminding us that we are positioned with a purpose. And through your will and through your guidance and through your way, we can move from dreamers to bridge builders. And I pray that you continue to bestow blessings across this campus and in our community and in our country and in our world, and that we can continue to build bridges together. It is in your name that I pray. Amen.
All right, would you please stand with me and extend your hands as we do our community benediction? Keep your eyes open, hold tight to your convictions, give it all you've got, be resolute, in love without stopping.